Good evening. My name is Rajesh Bhatt, and I work as the co-founder and director of Headlight Services Private Limited. Before I begin the panel, I'll just share a couple of things about Headlight and what we do. That also links a little bit about innovation, right? A few years ago, we took a few people who were completely illiterate, who could not write a single letter. They could not write their name as well in any language. We took them through a program for about 6 months. These were villagers who could not, who had not seen any city, who would not come to the city, who would not read the bus number or the nameplates. Took them through an 8-month program, and in 8 months, what they accomplished was astonishing. 8 months later, one of them went and met Mr. Tata, and Mr. Tata was so astonished. He said, "This can change the face of the country." And he said, immediately he said, "Okay, I will invest about 50 lakhs into the entire model for us to be able to scale this." We took the money from Mr. Tata, came back and said, "Okay, let's really build this into a model." And I went and stayed in a village for about an year and said, "Okay, how can we build this as a model to be able to for us to scale?" And we scaled it from 8 people to 120 people, and then more and more people. In the next year, we'll be reaching about 2,000 people in total who we would have trained from similar backgrounds. People who would be completely zero educated, people who would be, passing 10th standard and so on. And just a few months back, we got an investment. We just raised an investment, and it's also going to be driven by my partner, who's a well-known charter member of TAI, Madan Padki, right? So, to just give you a sense of the possibility itself. So, what we have now is a model which I believe can actually be transformational in education, because what we have figured out is to take somebody from any level of education and transform into somebody with from one extreme end to the other extreme, right? With that, I will hand over, because the time is really short, and we have eminent panelists who will be sharing with us about education in various models. I don't want to spend a lot of time introducing the panel members, because most of them are already well known. So Dr. Ravindra, he's with more than 40 years of experience in the industry. He's the president of IUCEE Society India, and he's been a speaker in more than 300 seminars across the world. So Keshavan is the product manager. So Keshavan is one of the reasons why we are sitting here and not outside in the park and not having samosas. Is Vodafone has sponsored this event, right? Right, Keshavan. So he manages product. He is a product manager at Vodafone, and he has been pioneering a lot of products in the education segment, the K-12 and so on as well. We have Rajiv. Rajiv is from Ernst & Young. He practices iBanking for education sector at Ernst & Young, and he's going to be. So I'll also share with you a little later, what they're going to speak. So Prashant is with us. Prashant is a partner at Accel Partners. He's on the board of too many companies for me to read, so I'm not going to read them. Right? Prashant is essentially a partner at Accel Partners, and I'll let him speak about himself a little more. He's founded Netcraft and many other organizations as well. So I'll let him share about himself later. Right. So what we're going to do now is we're going to allow the panel members to speak. They're going to only, and I've been asking them for the last 3 days to speak only for 5 minutes. Okay, so that we have more interactions, and we have time to share and lot of interactions, right? We are going to spend the next 5 minutes each. We are going to have each of the panel members. So, if you have any questions, what you could do is you Prathana, have you passed on the chits to people? So you have the chits. So you can write the name of the panel member and keep it with you. We'll collect it later. We'll spend the last 15-20 minutes answering questions, taking questions from the audience, right? So first we're going to have Dr. Ravindra speak about current on-ground realities and maturity of solutions for education. So may I request Dr. Ravindra to go ahead, please.
Thank you.
So we'll have, so I, you know, we'll next have Keshavan, Rajiv and Prashant speak about various topics. We'll come to that later.
Hi, good evening. Privileged to be here. You know, like the current situation, it's too compressed. The topic itself is too profound and too deep and too varied. And to say something sensible in 5 minutes, it's in itself a challenge. That's actually the reality of education today. In fact, so much of knowledge is getting created, which people have to be connected to. You know, even the best of teachers are finding it difficult to expose even a little bit about it in the college when they're there. But whereas in the industry, we expect people to be ready to go. So this particular void will remain and will remain ever in spite of whatever we may put in place. And you know, in order not to get into any trouble, I've got a foolproof technology that is pen and paper. Because I lost my iPad and my laptop, everything, when I was traveling last time to US. It got robbed and I haven't yet invested back into that. I had actually promised that I'll talk about some of the segments that we need to attack, actually. Most of it, actually, in Anand's speech we heard. But one sector that he actually missed out was in terms of the people who are actually already outside the college and are into work life, be it entrepreneurs or be it people who work for others. The rate of change in technology, rate of change in the knowledge that is necessary to live in the current world and the world of the future, I think is a serious one, and all of us really need to go through a lot of recertifications on topics which we have professed long time ago. Otherwise, you can't even be playing the game. So essentially, what I would say is that's another major space which is actually available to us, apart from the other spaces that Anand identified. Now, what I will do is, that is the market segment, that's all there. But when we really create any kind of a product for this particular space, what is the number that is actually realizable? Because if I start really putting all of them into matrix, which goes by the cultural angle, the preparations that people are coming into this with, and what is required from the outside world, because the outside world, according to me, is the world, because most of us studied in India. You know, in fact, when Anand asked the question, how many of us have went and studied in UK or US or Europe, I think most of us did not. But if I really look at the 30, 40 years that I have spent in the industry, most of my customers were outside the country. And whenever we actually delivered something, they would say, no, this is not suitable for us because of 1, 2, 3. The reason why this kind of a gap exists is because we don't understand the cultural context the way they think. So it is not enough if we basically push the content. Is it adjusted to a particular market? So that localization, we will have to think about when we create anything. It may be content, the method, whatever it may be. I think that's a serious area that I feel has not got attention. And I would say that mobility in education is unavoidable anyway. And that is because it is not sustainable in the current model. The brick and mortar model is out. It is just not going to survive because there is not enough space. If we go by the AICTE and UGC standards, whole of the country has to be universities, nothing else. Because that is the kind of space that they demand if you want to give quality education. So honestly speaking, there is not enough space in the country or the world, nor the energy to run those things. I personally believe that mobility in education, in terms of delivering education to where the customer is going to become a reality. Because the learning that we get when we are in the context when we need it, is the best learning we get. When you are on the job, you hit a roadblock, you get the input that you want, whatever this means, I think the registering will be much superior, will be remembered long, and you know how to innovate that. So essentially, this innovation, therefore, becomes absolutely essential. Then it's an economic need also. How many people can afford the current escalation in cost of education? Is there something that we can do to reduce the per capita expenditure in educating a person? And educating for what has to be an answer that we have to find out, because this general education is not going to help in tomorrow's context, because it's getting sliced more and more in terms of what we do, how we do things. So essentially, it's become an economic need. So unavoidability of mobile education, therefore, is understood and critical. And I've done enough experiments with regard to this in Infosys when I was the head of education and research. I had a serious challenge of providing education anytime, anywhere. And I can tell you, not more than 10%, 15% success was there for us, purely because technology is lagging, there are not enough products. Then comes the assessment tools. I've had serious difficulties, because when once the number goes above a particular level, I have had situations when some 300 people would have written the assessment, and then before they actually save it, the system has crashed. We don't know what really was the problem. And this has happened. Some people taking examinations in US, some people in Australia, some people in Europe, and it crashes. And I would really be woken up in the dead of night purely because they are all very angry. Because many people have driven miles when it's snowing. And just imagine what happens if the person has done the assessment and I won't register that. Think of that. So what are those kinds of things that we can do? And that's what I want to point out, that when we talk of mobility, how do I assure that last minute connectivity absolutely guaranteed? Without that, some of this can get into a problem. Then comes the question of, very important question of, how well is it adjusted to the learner? In case of even a class, we have a difficulty in terms of, what I call as establishing a rapport with the class, every student, and I'm able to watch them, and in spite of it, learning is not guaranteed. At the end of the day, has the person learned? Can this person apply it in different contexts? Does he know how to extend the ideas and concepts that I've given him? Serious challenges. And in case of these distant learners who I can't get, what is going to happen? How do I know that they have caught the spirit of what I'm trying to convey to them? So how are we going to understand what we call as the teaching-learning process? Because all of us are not same type of learners. According to research, it is found that there are four types of learners, and each of them need that nuancing to be done. So there is a pre-assessment which has to be sensitive enough to say that in this class of 100 people who are registered with me, where do these people belong? What sort of learners are they? How should I convey a particular concept? So these are the other interesting opportunities that according to me exist and not yet cracked. And then, I already touched upon the segments, the elementary, higher education, higher secondary, and then undergraduate and much higher. And skill-based, that the WPLP as they call, that is workplace learning, how are we going to attend to that? Because they are all adult learners, the whole thing has to change. Because adult learner comes to me with a purpose. He does not come because somebody has pushed me into it. So there is a change that is required. And as already Anand commented, the pyramid is extremely steep today. I don't agree with Anand entirely that it is actually serviced already, because we don't have any alternatives for the other 220 million kids who are going to come to the college level in another 15 years. And if we leave them on the streets, there is no peace in this country. So it's not going to happen. And we are not talking of just India, we are talking of two-thirds of the world. And that's going to be a serious challenge, and we have to do something about it. And there are opportunities, according to me, in those spaces. And then the adjustment in terms of NLP. I'm sure that all of you relate to this concept, that is non-linguistic programming, because not all of us actually learn by listening or by just seeing or by feeling. So it has to be nuanced with regard to the NLP concepts also. These are some of the technical skills and things like that. But I will leave a question on the table, because how do we teach them just innovation and not the ethics? Because even when we are really sitting in front of each other, we are not able to drive the ethics learning. Knowledge application correctly is a serious challenge. How we are going to accommodate those aspects of creating human beings and not just automatons, I think will be remaining a challenge. Great opportunities. With that, I will pass it to the other panelists. Thank you.
Thank you.
Hello, everybody. My name is Keshavan, and my first thanks to Tai for putting this great session together. So I, on behalf of Vodafone, first of all, thank you everybody. Secondly, thank you everybody for coming. And just to give you a little bit of context on what, how we began this journey at Vodafone, we looked at education as a sector. So we formed a separate team at Vodafone, looking at emerging market problems, and not just India, and also countries that are very similar in terms of, you know, population, education, and all of that, like Africa. And we formed this group specifically to move beyond just connectivity. So obviously somebody spoke about, Vodafone primarily plays the role of a connectivity provider. But the viewpoint that we took at Vodafone was, we can create an ecosystem to enable experiences like in sectors like education, whereby our basic corporate goal is further, like consumption of internet and things like that. So we went down the road of creating an ecosystem of partners to working together in bringing consumer experiences in areas like education, right? So that's the mandate for our team. And as we began this journey about a year and a half, a couple of years ago, and as part of this team, we've undertook projects in various areas, like K-12, obviously, which is a very large area, as somebody spoke a little earlier. We did work in higher education also, and also at in vocational training. So if you look at the markets, they are very varied. The kind of challenges that exist in each of these markets are very, very different from one another. So specifically talking about K-12, let me talk about each of the experiences that we've had. We went down the direction of enabling. So obviously when you look at this market, K-12 is close to 250 million students, a very large addressable market. So people tend to get misled by just the sheer size of the opportunity, right? So one of the key things that we wanted to understand is, how do we create value in this space? And we started from the school system. So we looked at, how can we enable teachers in becoming more productive in the classroom, and how do you make the classroom more engaging for the students, and how can we bring mobility and content and the resources of Vodafone as a company to enable that to happen, right? So we started with a classroom solution. We enabled about 1,000 schools. Actually, it's still under rollout. And you know, again, talking about our experiences so far, I think from an entrepreneur's perspective, we look at how connectivity, application, and user experience will be primary drivers for adoption of the product and thereby commercialization, right? But if you look at it, it's interesting because the number of stakeholders within the system are so varied. The number of people that need to actually need to be trained, need to be in line with what the goal that you want to achieve are so many, that the fundamental problem of educating the student is actually the easiest challenge. The largest challenge just to give you a little bit more insight, half of the spend in terms of our costing has gone towards teacher training. The teacher is actually the custodian of the classroom, right? So it is in her hands about how well the pupil is able to grasp a concept, apply that concept, and tomorrow create something after having learned that concept, right? The highest order of learning.
And now the current trend is how to enable students to learn on their own. This trend has already set in and is already changing thanks to internet and mobile technologies and increasing broadband penetration and proliferation of mobile devices. What all this is doing is enabling individualized learning and personal learning for each student at a pace and place of the student's choosing. And from in my view, this opportunity, as many have mentioned already, is available across all the segments, sub-segments of education, whether it is in K-12 through after-school learning, in test preparation, as Keshavan just pointed out, in higher education, where distance education will become increasingly important. It's already important enough to be accounting for 25% plus of the overall enrollments in Indian higher education. And increasingly in the future, technology will drive the rollout of distance education. That's inevitable. As well as in vocational and professional certification education, where learners want greater flexibility. And if I look at the statistics of the last 5 years and investment statistics of the last 5 years and specifically of the last 2 years, I see this trend impacting the investments as well. There have been 30 plus, if the last 5 years accounted for 100 investments in the education sector, each of the last 2 years in 2011 and 12 alone have accounted for 30 plus transactions in each of the years. And the largest subsegment of largest subsegment receiving investments is digital learning or education technology. And many of these digital learning or education technology companies were companies that were focusing on reaching out to the students directly. And many of these companies that have been funded, as I said, are companies reaching out to the students directly. Some examples I will give you of these companies in different subsegments. These include companies in the K-12 and test preparation segment, companies like iProf and Merit Nation. In the higher education or vocational education space or skill certification space, we've seen a number of companies getting funded. Companies like EduPristine, companies like Simply Learn, and companies like Edusys. And these companies have using technology been able to reach out to international markets sitting out of India without having a physical presence in those international markets, and that is a very heartening trend. We also see companies that are reaching out to students via schools and colleges, but trying to create a brand in the minds of students. Companies like Edutor who are powering mobile-based education, a company like eDreams EduSoft, which is using a very innovative adaptive learning technology and serving students through schools, but enabling individualized and personalized learning. In summary, I think investors today are more excited about investing in education technology companies because using these new technologies in internet and mobile space, companies today have an opportunity to create an education brand. And globally, some of the largest brands across any industry are education brands. And this excites investors. And education technology entrepreneurs today have a great opportunity to sort of create these brands and make use of the opportunity. And there's a favorable investment climate supporting them. Thanks.
Yeah, it's great to be here, and I'm the last speaker, so I guess most of it has been covered, but I'll try to give you a couple different perspectives as an investor. I'll start out by saying that there's an opportunity for entrepreneurs here to submit your business plans. Accel is running a program called EduStars, which is, so you can go to your story and submit as entrepreneurs, you can submit your, and I think it's open till end of November. You can submit your business plans and we'll pick a couple of them and they'll be mentored and taken forward. So that's one opportunity for entrepreneurs here. But you know, I'll kind of temper a little bit of Rajiv and other. I think there's been we have done about 6 investments in education right now. I think distribution is a major problem. So you going straight to the student is the holy grail. You know, nobody wants to go sell to schools and colleges and go the tough route. But you know, getting students to pay or parents to realize the value of the digital platforms, and so parents still want their kids to go to a a tutorial somewhere, be bounded by the four walls of the teacher, and they think that you know, somehow he's going to still learn better because there's going to be supervision by that teacher there. So that's reality in India. So it's going to, so the really the opportunity is in blended learning, or providing tools which empower the teacher to extend what the teacher does in class and personalize what the teacher will be doing for the student, extend that capability to learn back home. And when the student comes back from home to class, you understand better, you know, the weakness of the student, and be able to deliver a better experience, holistic experience for the student. I think maybe that's in the higher ed space. In the higher ed space, we have JEDI, one of our companies, Swami is here. So even there, the reality is blended learning, right? So there is, and the lower you go, it's very difficult to get the students to be motivated. If you have an 8th standard, 9th standard, 10th standard student, I don't think anybody really wants to spend that time. I mean, there's of course these 2-3 students in the class who just want to learn all the time. But otherwise, the rest of them, you know, learning is the last thing. I mean, they're not going to become popular in the school for being on the top of the class. They're going to be popular for other things, and they just want to focus on those, right? So it's very difficult to get students, and this is globally, this is just not here. This is a big challenge even in the US to get students to, you know, be self-motivated. But as you move up, you know, if you go all the way up to your corporate, in corporate learning, I think digital learning is here. You know, we have a great company called Mindtickle. You should look at it. You know, where they have been able to make this whole process of learning more democratic. You know, if you have content in the, so you had the old generation of LMSs where, you know, it took 3 months or 4 months for a corporate to get out a new course. So what Mindtickle does is it just sucks in the existing content and just gamifies it and makes it more learning, more interesting for the employee, right? So you'll see a lot of this self-empowerment and self-paced learning first show up in its entirety in corporates, and then there'll be a little bit more, I guess, more online and less blended when you come to higher ed. And as you come down to schools, I think in K-12, for the reasonable future, I think it'll be more teacher-driven digital experience, and with the student participating in that experience. So that's our view. And India has been, you know, additionally challenging, you know, the propensity of people to pay. Like I said, parents don't mind spending 20, 30, 40, 50, even a lakh of rupees for a tutorial, but they don't want to spend 5,000-10,000 rupees for an online program. So entrepreneurs have to sell to these tutorials. They have to do this whole B2B selling process, which is very time consuming. And, you know, there's looks like there's no easy way to scale. In fact, you know, one of the things, I think the one big opportunity is to have a company that enables, see, you have 10, 15, 20 companies in India, each providing a point digital solution, one in math and one in, you know, just thinking programs and so on and so forth to schools. If you had a channel for distribution, somebody could come up with a great channel where they could put either in higher ed or otherwise build a relationship with a bunch of schools and enable the distribution of multiple solutions. I think there's a great opportunity there, because I think just creating one more tool, and schools are being bombarded. Honestly, if you go talk to a school, I think they're also getting confused what really is providing value for their children, right? So it's become a marketing fad, right? So they every year use one new thing that comes down the pike to market and say that their school is better than the next one. But outside of that, you know, it's very difficult to see real examples where either usage of tablets or mobile phones or anything at scale having made a big difference in India, and it's sad, but you know, that's where reality is. But this does not mean that, you know, this is not going to happen in 5-10 years. But my submission is, don't expect as entrepreneurs to build these big companies out of India, which are purely digital led, and become $10-15 million in revenue. Have realistic expectations. You're probably in this for the next 5-10 years, so you have to really pace yourself and not build ahead of the market. It's never going to help. So you can't change the perception of parents. You can't change the perception or the ability of schools to adopt this program and these solutions. So you got to pace yourself, build with the market, and hopefully then this is a real opportunity for everybody. Thanks.
Thank you. Thank you, everyone. So, sure, please go ahead.
So, Prashant, very contrarian, please, okay. Right? Provocatively, yes. Contrarian, yes. Because I think all of us have heard this very silently.
Yes. Don't know if this works, yeah. But.
Ravi, we put our money where our mouth is, and we are still not seeing it. So
no. So Prashant and I go a long way back. So
Ravi was my partner before.
We were partners. So the reason for the contrarian view is, I think all that I've heard today, with all due respects, is about technology delivering content. Right? We talked about how that content is going to reach out. It's a self-service where somebody is going to consume content. And so it's all that I heard about as technology was in the delivery mechanism of that content, MOOC, otherwise, etc. I will argue that delivery has always been an issue. It will continue to be an issue. The same thing was said to me a few years ago when we had the FM channel coming up specifically for education. The same thing was true when we had the broadcast pieces of Doordarshan doing a separate channel just for getting delivery of content out to market. So my point that I'm trying to do is, how much of technology is actually going to make a difference to the 250 million people who are studying if we are going to rely on technology to enable the last mile, which is just the delivery capability? You're not increasing the curiosity. You're not increasing the ability for them to be able to distinguish what is good or bad. And all we are doing is taking an existing model, adding digital to the delivery mechanism, and also adding digital for the outcome by assessment. Right, that's what we are doing. We are doing the end, not at the start of the, or the head of the waterfall.
So Ravi, there even, I think globally, if you see, people have talked about collaborative learning, you know, making learning more exciting, where groups of people have, where students can, challenge each other, in a digital environment. And if you're talking about those kinds of things which make a difference, again, I've not seen good examples of that globally, right? So when you had this company, I think Edmodo, right? Edmodo. So Edmodo said that we'll make our tool look like Facebook, right? So when people come online, they'll start relating to this because they used to first Facebook. But at least my learning on this from talking to different people in the US has been that and when students use Edmodo, if they have a specific supervised kind of session, then they kind of behave differently. But if you just leave them to collaborate, and I think the maturity in a K-12 environment for them to handle a tool like that is not easy. So I think the best I can say is what Khan has done, right? So he's at least taken the curiosity to a level where if a student wants to learn about anything, he or she now has that capability to just pull it up and further their curiosity, right? So I think other than and again, there it will be students who are curious. So I think the problem is that, you know, 80-90% of the students are going to be in that category, Ravi, where they're going to just follow what the teacher says.
Ravi, I have been really trying to do a few things in that space of how the content has to be created, what should be the structure, the direction, the flow, to create interest in the student, and then the learning starts happening. Honestly speaking, it is not so much about the, you know, that particular space which is not understood well, but who is going to take care of the parents in the whole thing, game plan? Because parents are pushing for marks at the end of the exam, and they are really driving the whole thing very differently. Unfortunately, it's not working for them, they are not realizing.
Which is why the assessment companies are getting funded, right?
Exactly. So what I wanted to say is that there is a social change that has to go on, and that's what I think all of us have experienced, and Anand also alluded to that when he talked about it's going to take time. But reality is that through the organization that I'm running right now, the Indo-US collaboration, we are actually trying to change the way engineering is taught in the institutions. We have worked with about, you know, 400, 500 to begin with, but now we have seen only about 75, 80 of them are absorbing it, and slowly the brand is building because those colleges are getting complete admissions every year for the last 3 years, because they have been able to see the change and placements for those colleges has improved. So what I would say, while I agree with you, in the short term, these changes are not going to happen because there is something else that is not getting done in terms of the social change, and that needs to be treated elsewhere. We can at best talk about technology in this particular thing, is my opinion. Thank you.
Thank you. So I have a question, you know, something similar from two, three people. So one question to all the panel members is, how does an education startup differentiate itself from the other startups? Or how does an education startup, what and how do you, and specifically to Excel Partners, how would you figure out what to fund, and what would be the top three parameters that you would look at when an education startup applies for funding? Yes.
I think the first question to answer for oneself is, what is the solution, what is the problem that you're addressing, and how are you solving it, number one. Number two, how is it that you're going to get either schools or students or parents pay you, and number three, how are you reaching out to these customers and accessing them? Because, you know, even many of the companies that we sort of talk about today have not necessarily addressed all these questions, but are going out and creating these products and reaching out to the consumers in the belief that, for example, the problem of access or payments will happen. You know, whether we talk about US-based MOOCs or many of the companies in India reaching out to customers. So there's no one simple answer to that, but I think depending on what offering you are taking out there in the market, one, you have to assess these things for yourself and answer this, and then go out to investors to talk about seeking funding. Prashant?
In the short term, I think we are looking at companies that can go after a global opportunity. So like Rajiv was alluding, we have one company called EduPristine, which provides CFA, CPA, and financial modeling, and you know, those kinds of programs online globally. So you can be a CPA sitting in the US and you want to learn financial modeling or enhance your skills in financial modeling, you just come online and learn that, right? So there is a opportunity to leverage our ability to create content. Again, the quality of that content and the your ability to make that content of global standards, we have seen is not easy, right? So it's not natural for people here to do that kind of content. But if you can do that, and if you can deliver it globally, and if there's a demand for that content globally, so there's a company called lynda.com, right? So which Accel US has funded. So all they do is just simple, you know, how to learn golf, you know, how to use Word, you know, Word better, right? So it's a $100+ million company, and you know, you might see some such content plays come out of India where they're able to now, because there's no barrier of distribution, right? You have because this is not for K-12, so you have, so you don't have that parent problem here, the school problem. So you, so this is used, like Ravindra was saying, you know, continuing basically people to upgrade their skills, and I think that's the big opportunity. Global, if you can create a product that can help people to upgrade their skills just in time, either in organizations or outside globally, I think there's an opportunity there. But you know, it's not easy, because you've got to create content that is of that quality and make it engaging and make it work.
Thank you. So I think one of the other questions that the other question that's been asked is, how does a startup in education compete with the existing players? What could be the, you know, factors? Have you answered that question already? How does an education startup differentiate itself from the existing players in the sector?
So here you're assuming that it's a standalone. So you're talking about the brick and mortar education.
Yes, players? We're not talking about technology per se. We're talking about any education startup. Also, in the audience, we have a lot of startups in the education sector itself.
Not necessarily
in a technology.
Yeah, I think, you know, there, you know, that's a very broad question, right? So it's like, what do you need to do to differentiate a business? So it's as broad as that. So in the education space, I think actually the if you're looking at building, you know, small to medium sized businesses, I think the opportunities are kind of infinite. I mean, like Ravindra was saying, it's the pyramid is really still pretty skewed, right? There's not a lot of quality out there, so there is a big opportunity for providing the right quality, and you know, Indians are great value seekers, right? So we've seen this across some of our Indian startups that you know, they're great in discovering value. So if you are able to provide the right price point and provide that, just that enough quality that meets that price point, you don't have to do anything else in India. There's no marketing required, then nothing, right? So that's, it's a very, very, you know, easy takeaway from this session, but, you know, but we have seen it work.
Yeah, and who's going to pay and at what price point?
That's it. And you just have to price it right and provide the right quality, and people will just flock to you.
The other aspect that I'd like to mention, so I'm presuming that by large companies you mean large education-oriented companies.
Yes.
So I think there's a misconception that large education companies have the resources and they've figured it all. That is completely not true. So over the last year and a half, I've had the good fortune of working with the so-called large companies, every one of them, the household brands that you might think of in India, and you know, internet as a experience medium is something that the large companies today don't get. That's true across the board, and it's kind of surprising. So today, the kind of user experience design that you what generally people incorporate when you look at websites in the US in the edtech space, they're nowhere near that. And internet as a design philosophy and a consumer experience platform is something that is still today, even today, right for people, for entrepreneurs who have the right skills to bring to the education sector, right? The key here is to, you know, not try to boil the ocean, because it won't happen. You will not be able to educate 230 million kids in any given period of time, you know, for a small startup to look at. So really, and that again, talking about differentiation, how do you differentiate yourselves? See, today, education is such a vast field, that's actually the most easiest thing to do. The whole instructional design about how content has to be created, what a child who's in K-12 preschool, there are lots of, you. I mean, if you go, to, I mean, I don't know how many people have kids, you know, in preschool age, just go to Play Store or the App Store on the iOS platform. Preschool based applications, and you'd see the sheer number of them that are there out there. So even there are small pockets like TestPrep we talked about, which may be small in sheer student number, but in terms of the sheer number of the amount of money spent in that sector is really huge, right? So instructional design, the way the content is designed, the kind of impact that it can deliver, and the sheer rigor of creating that content can it in itself be a differentiator, right? There is good content out there and there is really poor content out there. So even that, something as basic as that can be a differentiator today, right?
Wonderful, thank you. So any other questions, anyone?
I sit on the board of Karnataka Vidyan Parishad, trying to design the mathematics curriculum for the entire state. See, what we have identified is, let's take only math education. Math is a phobia, and everybody.
True.
And there is a lot of opportunity over there.
True.
And if you ask me, most technology-based companies, including NIIT, have failed to give the right kind of tools to the students. So we have found a couple of companies who provide these manipulatives, okay, hands-on activities. And that's where the student wants touch and feel. It's not just looking at the specific screen or just touch and feel on a technology platform. So I feel we should go beyond the technology of the softwares and things like that. I feel we should look at those kinds of technologies where you can scale the brick and mortar style also, because if you go to a rural area, and if you, I'll tell you, the same thing will change when US will start off with touch and feel. suppose tomorrow Harvard says the touch and feel factor works there, we'll implement it. I'll give a simple example of something called as Tower of Hanoi, which is called as Tower of Brahma. And if you see, the same Tower of Hanoi is used in Massachusetts Institute of Technology to develop search engine algorithms. And I've seen companies here in Bangalore developing the same technology for school kids to teach them permutation and combination. Not touch and feel factor. That's why I say something innovation in education, which is beyond just technology, but which can kindle the mind to make them understand the concepts, and also try to take people away from engineering field also. We have a skewed society of engineers coming out good for nothing. I'm sorry to say that, that's a sad fact. Everybody feels that if you're not an engineer, especially, I don't know if some people are from AP, in AP if you're not an engineer, you don't get bribed.
or a good bribe.
Or a good bribe, whatever it is. And what's important is basic sciences. And if people, I'm sure in next 10 years, the demand for BSc and BCOMs, especially BSc, is going to come up, and pure science will be a sheer choice for people, because research is going to be very much necessary. And I feel research is one field, or knowledge is one field which is non-depreciating. So if you can focus on those areas, for example, how many people are there? There are hundreds of players working towards IITians. How many players are there in India training for Olympiads? And if you see, China is the only country which has 7 gold medals. Okay, India stands 72nd, and we call ourselves good at mathematics. So there are players which, if actually look at a different perspective, I think we can change a different space structure. That's a space where there is definitely wealth at the bottom of the pyramid, and it has to be tapped, I think, beyond technology. That's what is my perspective. Maybe somebody can comment on this.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you. I think the one of the key messages that's coming out from earlier discussion and this as well is who's going to pay, what price point, and if you're tracking that, then that's one of the biggest things. So before,
one quick question. Do you guys see any big platform emerging? I mean, there was a brief mention that there are many point solutions, but there is not one platform that's bringing them together. If a platform will come, where do you think it will come first?
You're talking about
an education platform delivery solution, delivery or the learning platform, be it a tablet, or will it be a ecosystem of players, or will it be an app store for the education content?
I would see it going towards the cloud as the means of delivery, and several players will collaborate, or there will be a coalescing of companies who bring in some of the point solutions and make it a continuum, and you can go through across. So I don't think there is a solution in that direction right now, because the number of items that come together are too many in education. So people are working at different points, but as you see today, villages are taken and the development happens, then the city gobbles up all the villages nearby. Same kind of phenomenon will occur here also. But I do not know any platform, but certainly open source cloud are the way to go, and that's where it will be. It will just not be a traditional way of putting things together.
Just one, I'd like to add that, the big way it's been made a platform is by Apple in the US, right? So if you see Amplify and Edmodo, everybody in the class has an iPad, right? And the teacher has iPad, and they're on a fixed platform. So everything that needs to come in there comes through that App Store or whatever the platform that the teacher and the students manage. So I think to that extent, very coherent, uniform device which brings people together has made it happen. But otherwise, are you building for Windows? Are you building for Androids? Android phones, iOS, and again, there probably won't be any single platform.
In India, that's going to be Android.
Yeah, but it's going to be very, disparate, right? I don't think you'll have one single platform that will dominate anything, right?
You need a full stack, right? The full stack that will hold the multiple point solutions together.
Yeah, but again, you need people to participate, and you need to be big enough to get everybody to participate with you. Right.
One experiment that was really tried out in US was this Qali, and it's not gone anywhere because they couldn't agree on standards, so nothing could happen. You see, even after 10, 12 years and millions of dollars of investment, it has not reached where it has to, and I think only a few parts of that have been adopted by 5 or 10 universities. So, honestly speaking, agreeing to some kind of a common standards, common minimum, is a serious challenge, because academic community generally are different. Okay, I belong there, so I can tell you that. They are a different kind of species, okay?
So maybe the last thing I'll say is that you'll see marketplaces, right? So a marketplace could be a platform. And you'll have multiple people who want to participate in that. It could be universities, it could be individual content contributors, it could be whoever, will participate in that marketplace and make stuff available, and people will purchase and transact on that. That probably is more practical.
That's where the Vodafone kind of players can...
Yeah, maybe, yeah. And I think that's a little bit how Coursera and Udacity, all of these guys are going. Slightly more on marketplace.
Wonderful. So we have...
referring to the article that came in Economic Times today for EdQuam, what is the message that you want to give it to a startup to see a size of company at that level being involved in that kind of fraudulent activities, how they need to strengthen their financial system to make sure that they are going to sustain a long run?
See, fortunately for startups, that won't be a problem for quite some time. I mean, if you have such big revenue, it's a good problem to have. But I think Rajiv will agree with me. I think the biggest disservice that has happened to this education, see, we had in IT, the initial folks who actually started IT in India, whether it's Infosys, and you tend to be given a lot of credit for running companies with the highest degree of governance and credentials. So everything kind of the momentum. But if you across the board, the top three, four, I'll not name them, education companies that have gotten big have done a big disservice to this country, right? Unfortunately, hopefully we'll see that change.
Wait for the next big three.
And frankly, that's one thing under an entrepreneur's control. I mean, that's something that either you allow it to happen or you don't allow it to happen. And if you make a conscious choice to say that I will not allow something like that to happen, then no one else can force you to get into such a situation.
Appoint the right CFO.
CFO also right for whom? Whether community or a CEO is more important.
Right. So before we close this session, so we have a lot of startups in the room. So I want to ask all the people who are looking at investing in the education space, seed funds, VCs, anybody who's investing in the education space, can you please raise your hands? Anybody who's looking at investing, looking at putting money, please raise your hands. So everybody, who's looking at investing, okay? Who's looking for opportunity, right? There, one there, a few here. Okay, good. So people who are looking at mentoring, startups, mentoring and looking at mentoring startups, please raise your hand. Excellent. So all the other startups, anybody who's looking at mentoring, please make note. We come to the end of the session, the panel discussion.
Excuse me, yes. I just want to have one clarification on one point. In fact, everybody is talking about.
Some of you ask questions about content, reach out to the panel members and ask those questions. The panel members, Dr. Ravindra, Prashant, Sasharjeev, Keshav, thank you very much for the discussion. Thank you very much for taking this on. And thanks Vodafone for the sponsorship. Thank you very much.
Folks, don't go anywhere. We have three entrepreneurs who are actually going to give